This is a guy that I met here at Dirt Time a couple of years ago. Actually, it was right here at Silverwood. And when I first met him, I could assume immediately that he was knowledgeable in some certain areas of bushcraft as well as trapping. And as I've gotten to know him, he has become a pretty good friend. He tolerates me on occasion, and I have found out that he has a ton of information on trapping, among other skills. Like myself, he doesn't just do one thing. He does a lot of things. But we all seem to have our area of expertise. Mine is bullshit. His is traps. Okay? He has a YouTube video channel you may want to check out. It's
Wilderness Outfitters.
Wilderness Outfitters.
Yes.
Dot
this YouTube. On YouTube, you search Wilderness Outfitters.
Wilderness Outfitters. And he has a lot of good information on there. He's a great guy, very knowledgeable. You're going to learn some stuff here in class, and you're going to go out and you're going to play with this stuff. This is going to be a very interesting class. So let's hear it for Steve Critter Davis.
Thank you. First, I want to start by saying it's a huge honor for me to be invited to Dirt Time. To be counted amongst these guys as an instructor at Dirt Time is a real big deal. What we want to talk about today is we're going to talk about trapping. A lot of these classes, somebody will teach one trap to some fancy whiz-bang trap, and we never discuss about the hows, the whens, and the whys. So we're going to lean real heavy on that today. We can have the best trap in the world, but if we set it in the middle of the parking lot, it's not going to do us a damn bit of good. You also have to pardon my language, because I cuss like a sailor and I try not to, so
we're trying.
If I let one slip, yeah. That's just me. So
we don't care for it. Okay.
All right, first thing I want to review, and you know, through this a little bit, you're going to wonder where I'm getting to, but it'll all come together for you. I want to review our priorities of survival. We're talking about a survival situation, and I absolutely hate the word survival situation. Does anybody here want to get out of a survival situation?
Yeah.
Why? Are you not surviving right now?
I suppose I am.
We get out of a survival situation, by definition, we just die. You're surviving every day. I hate that word. You know, maybe a wilderness self-reliance situation. That the whole survival thing just drives me crazy.
Or I'm on a camping trip that got extended.
All right, well, we'll get to this, but you know, if you let me finish talking, we'll get on with it. All right, let's review our priorities. In a survival situation, our first priority should always be fire and or shelter. Why fire and shelter? Hyperthermic situation with the shelter keeps us out of this California sun, right? After that, water. We can go a lot longer time without food than we can water. Okay? Now we're going to go back to signaling. Because after I have these, I want to get the hell out of here. Right? So I'm going to try to set up a way to signal. And then I'm going to go to food. Notice I don't say trapping, because food can be everything from wild edibles to meat. Me, I prefer meat. If it didn't walk, I probably don't want to eat it. That's just, there's a reason humans have forward-facing eyes and canine teeth. Our bodies are designed for meat. Vegetarians, you know, have at what you want, but your body is designed to eat meat. It is evident in just the way you're built. Now, encompassing all this is security. Our personal security. If we're doing any of this and our lives are endangered by the area we're in, the environment, that has to encompass everything. We always have to be mind of our personal security. So, keep that in mind, these priorities in mind as we go through the rest of this, and you'll see how it ties together. thing we need to do in trapping is find where we're going to trap. We need to take an area this big, and an animal from has a home range from anywhere from an acre to square miles, and get him to come to a trap and step in a circle that big. That's a lot of narrowing down. So we're going to start that narrowing down by landscape tracking. What we're going to do with landscape tracking is look at terrain features, the flora on these terrain features. Now let's take a look at this area, right? We have, say, the top of a mountain. Comes down to a valley. We have peaks, shelves, valleys. Then any way that an animal or a person can easily travel from a peak to a shelf to a valley, I call a cut or a draw. Animals are the masters of conserving calories. They are lazy. They will take the easiest route possible. They live out here, they do this all the time. It's just inbred in them. We have lost that through modern conveniences. So in an area like this, an animal is going to travel in the easiest place. He's not going to travel on the side of this hill. If you try to walk across the side of this hill, you know how much of a pain in the butt that is. He's going to travel on peaks, shelves, valleys, and any way he can get in between them. Now, a lot of these shelves, at least where I'm from, will have a sheer face. So you'll have a shelf, a barrier, and another shelf. Those barriers are very important, because that makes an animal travel in that spot. Most rabbits are not going to come to a 6-foot rock ledge and climb up it to get to the next shelf. He's going to travel down that barrier until he can find an easy way to get on top of it. Only humans are, you know, will risk their life and limb to do that, because we're not the masters that animals are. All right, that's just a couple terrain features to keep in mind. And on these terrain features, we're going to have different things. We're going to have cover. Cover is where an animal takes shelter and lives. We're going to have feeding areas. Depending on the animal, it could be different things. It could be these scrub oaks for some of these ground squirrels back here. It could be the ground squirrels and the scrub oaks for a predator, right? We got to keep that in mind, where they're going and why. So this is going to be a crude drawing. If I have this area over here, that's a bedding area. Okay? This area over here, we'll say, is this patch of scrub oaks. This is a feeding area. What's the one common thing that all animals need?
Water.
Water. Water. Animals feed on different types of things, so you're going to have different feeding areas. Animals are always going to go to water. So we'll say down here, we got some water. Alright. Let's talk about bedding areas real quick. Bedding areas are not the places to trap and hunt. If I come to your house and set up a trap in your bedroom, who knows that place better than you? Nobody. You're going to notice that right off the bat. Feeding areas are real hard to trap. It's hard to bait something into a trap when there's food all over the place, right? I mean, we're trying to narrow this down. So if there's food all over the place, what's the chances he's going to take mine? And keep that in mind. Now, water is the variable here, because when animals come to places like feeding areas and watering areas, if you ever watch deer, say, in a meadow eating, they stand next to their cover, they take a bite, what are they doing while they're chewing?
Scanning.
They're looking around, right? Same way with when they're in their bedding area. They're laying down, they're looking around. They're hard to get up on. What we want to focus on is the routes in between these. When you're least aware, try to think of yourselves in this situation. When you're least aware is when you're bebopping through the woods headed somewhere, right? We want to catch this animal when he's cruising through the woods, not paying as good of attention as he is when he's standing still, scoping everything out. So these are the areas we want to focus on. When we go out here later, we'll look around, and they're really easy to find. Now, landscape tracking is going to fall back in to all of our priorities that we talked about earlier. If I can look at this area and say, well, I got some dense brush over here, I got some water down here, blah, 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 that helps me with my own water, securing my own water. It helps me with my shelter. It helps me with my fire materials. It helps me figure out the best place to put my signal. Right? It all kinds of ties together there. So after we get these areas tied down, what we're going to start looking at is sign tracking. We're going to narrow this area down even smaller. What we're going to look at is prints or tracks. Scat. Disturbance. Refuse. Remains. Smell.
You mean remains like another dead animal?
That would be remains. All right, now I get back on my track, train of thought here. All right, prints and tracks, actual physical prints of an animal. What does that tell us? It tells us where they're traveling. It tells us what kind of animal's there, right? Scat. Now, I'm a guy that finds a pile of scat, and I dig through it with a stick. And a lot of people say, man, Steve, why are you down there digging through a pile of crap with a stick? I'm going to find out, one, what they're eating, what type of animal it is. Makes sense? Now we're narrowing things down. Disturbance. Oftentimes you can't find definable prints or tracks. Disturbance is something where, say, an animal moves through some brush and the grass is parted. Or some leaves on the forest floor are flipped up. In my area, in the hardwood forest, I have leaves this deep on the... If you can get a track in that, I'm pretty impressed. But what you can find is disturbance where an animal moved through this debris on the ground and moved it. And by that disturbance, the size of the disturbance, the spread of it, if it's real close together, I can tell it's a small animal. If it's 4 foot apart, I'm pretty sure that's a deer cruising through there. That's going to further help us narrow this down. Refuse is what an animal leaves behind. Down by this creek, there may be the shell of a crayfish. That's the refuse of, say, a coon eating crayfish. Or it may be chewed up nut shells. That's going to tell us, one, what they're eating, and two, what kind of animal it is. Remains. It's going to tell us what kind of animals are in the area, because obviously if his remains are here, then he was here. It's also going to tell us what other types of animals are in this area by what ate this animal, or what is chewing on the bones of this animal, like small rodents like to chew on bones and take the calcium out of it. And smell. How many people here can walk down a creek and smell muskrats or beavers? It's really easy to do if you pay attention to it. Or the easiest one to smell is skunk. Right? If you know what you're looking for, you can find scent posts all over the woods. And you can literally get down and smell them. And if you know what it is, you can tell what kind of an animal it is. So we're going to use that to narrow this on down. Alright, so we're going to get this area narrowed down. What kind of animals are in this area? Where they're traveling, where they're bedding, where they're feeding. Now this is going to help us on our other priorities, because where they're feeding may also be where we can feed. Where they're bedding is generally a really good sheltered place, because what, the animals are better at this than we are. I've been proven to be a dumbass by animals time after time after time. They're better.
Okay, now where was I going?
So anyways, we get this nailed down to these areas. We can see them. We know where we're going. We can tighten it down by the animal sign that's there to know what kind of animals are there, what they're feeding on. That's going to help us to know what kind of traps to use, what kind of bait to use. Out here, I'm sure there's deer running around here, that type of thing. Large animals, I'm sure. I've heard there's mountain lions out here, that type of stuff. Forget about that. If you can't easily pick up and carry this animal, forget about it. We were talking about seal hunting with a spear gun. There's one huge problem with snaring a deer. You got a deer in a snare.
You're not happy.
I mean, does that make sense? What the heck are you going to do with it? I mean, are you going to bludgeon it to death? And then what are you going to do with 80, 90 pounds of meat that it renders? In this heat, you better be able to make jerky really fast, or you're just wasting it. And we're, you know, doing unnecessary killing, and I just can't get along with that. You know, that's another thing we should talk about, is ethics in this. That's a huge thing. It always gets skipped. If you're going to kill it, you better need it, and you better eat it. If we go out here and set these traps up, and we catch a couple blue jays or a ground squirrel, which is not the most palatable of meat, guess what we're going to do? We're going to eat it. We're going to show the respect to this animal. We're going to take its life. We're going to use it. That's just the way it's got to be. And me personally, I cannot sleep at night knowing I just killed an animal for absolutely no reason. I trapped professionally, fur trap, for 20 years. I ran a long line 5 months of the year, and I'd have a shed with literally hundreds of hides in there, all for one thing, money. I turned about 32, I can no longer bring myself to kill for money. Unless they're jihadists, and then I don't mind. But see, I just wanted to throw that in there, you know, so. Alright, now, let's get down to trap types. And this is going to lead into how we're going to select them. We have snares. Powered snares. There's a big difference. And deadfalls. Blunt force trauma. Now there's a lot of different kinds of traps. You know, you got spring spear traps, different kind of whiz bang specialty traps. Those are all great, but the basics work everywhere. And this is where we, you know, a lot of times guys that are into primitive traps, we get hung up on this, you know, nifty whiz bang trap with all these intricate notches and stuff like that, and it takes 2 hours to make one. And you know, it's kind of an animal or an area specific trap, and those things are all fun to learn, but they don't work everywhere. They take a lot of time. So what we're going to try to do is make traps that we can place a large number of traps. I've had one trap set up for, well, since the second day of this event. It's been set off twice. I haven't caught anything. Now if I was relying on that one trap to feed me, I'd be pretty hungry right now. So trapping being a numbers game, we want to try to select these traps in a way that we can produce a bunch of them. Because the percentages get better the more number of traps you have. And if we're spending 2 hours making one trap, that's going to be less traps that we can get out. So we're going to try to keep this simple. If we can get 20 simple traps out, as we're taking care of our other priorities, and then we can move on to maybe making a little bit more intricate traps. The thing I found with primitive traps is the harder they are to make, the better they work. the easier they are to make, the less they work, but you got the numbers. So it all kinds of evens out. I'll go with the numbers every time. Every time. I can cover more ground that way. So, snares, just a plain old snare. Piece of metal wire here. I never make a static snare that is not powered out of anything that is not metal. For one reason, because an animal will chew his way right out of it if we use a natural cordage or like a nylon cord. If we get him snagged and we don't get him choked out right now, he will chew his way out of it and go. And then we just, you know, maybe left a noose around an animal's neck. He wanders off and dies, and we still don't have the meat. But for the static snare, it's really easy to do. Take a little stick, your wire, wrap it around her twice like that. Clear as mud? Everybody tracking?
You're tracking.
Then we're going to twist this around. Break that stick out of the middle, so I got this nifty little double loop. And I find this little barb on here to be quite important. I'm going to take my other end, feed it through here. And I got about the most basic snare you can make. What we're going to do with this is set this in an animal's runway. It's a blind set. Blind set is a set in a runway that is not baited. We're counting on our terrain and sign tracking to narrow down a spot where we know animals run. When we go out here a little later, you'll see in this grass, not quite as good now since we run a navigation class through it, but in this grass there's ground squirrel and wood rat trails everywhere. When we go out and we start looking at this stuff and you really start paying attention, it'll be something you've walked by 100 times since you've been here this week. But basically what we're going to do with this snare, this is my ground, let's imagine there's a runway through here. All we're going to do is get this snare set and anchored so when this animal comes down this runway, he runs into it. But we can set up some posts and such and funnel him in there so we force him through this, right? Look, let's look at the way a simple snare works. Basically, an animal comes into it, right? This little barb, why I said it's so important, it's going to help a snare close by an animal catching some hair or some hide in this, and it's going to help pull this down. So basically, we've got this animal on the end of a wire. Now, the way we anchor this is going to put a big difference into whether or not this works. This snare is relatively strong when you pull it like this, correct?
Yeah.
Have you ever seen an animal pull on a snare? It's like this. He's pumping it, working it. We got to anchor this to something flexible, yet strong enough to work as a shock absorber. Now, the problem I have a lot with ground traps like this and simple snares is this animal snared, he's still on the ground and he can't run, right? He can't run from anything else either. If I set this trap in Ohio and snare a rabbit in it this evening and wait till the morning to check it, that rabbit will not be there, I promise you. I promise you it won't be there.
Coyotes?
A coon, a coyote, or any of the raptors, they will have it. You might get part of the neck or something for yourself, but I'm not about feeding raptors, I'm about feeding me. So, it's simple, it's easy and quick to make, but unless you got wire, I don't suggest it just because the animal will chew its way out of it. And I've had it happen to me numerous times. But it is very effective, and wire is a very multi-versatile thing to have in your kit.
What's the best source?
For wire? Home Depot picture wire. That's what I use all the time. It's cheap. Make sure it's an annealed wire.
It's all standard, right?
A what wire?
Yeah, well, you can use either. That's just wire.
It's a what wire?
It's an annealed wire, which means it's softened, so it's got some flex and stuff to it. Now, my preferred...
Now, in terms of the size, I've heard it said that you want to put it four fingers above the ground and then...
Depends on the animal. If I'm trapping these ground squirrels, which are this big, if I have it 4 fingers above the ground, it'll go right under it. Right? We're going to get to that when we get to trap placement. We're just talking about some trap types right now. Now, my preferred trap method is a powered snare. And why that is if I got that animal in a snare, right? He's on the ground. He can pull, fight against that. The coons, the coyotes can get this animal before I can, right? If I have a powered snare, which lifts this animal up, not only is he fighting my snare, he's now fighting his own body weight. Which, if I catch him right, I can choke him out with his own body weight and him fighting on it. Second, he is up off the ground, away from everything that's trying to steal my meal. Make sense?
Yeah.
All right. Plus, on the, where's that ground snare at?
Right there. He's going around there.
Sorry, I didn't mean to take it back. Right? I got this ground snare on the ground, right? Animal comes into it, feels that resistance. What does he do? Backs up. With a powered snare, I'm going to close this loop for him. I'm not relying on him to close that loop. Make sense? Now, if you notice how I doubled that loop over on that ground snare as it's getting passed around, that double loop is so when it gets pulled on and tightens up, that double loop will collapse and tighten that loop up and sometimes lock it. I won't say it locks it. It sometimes locks it. Okay? Now, with a powered snare, we have the animal's body weight. We have our power source closing that snare for us. That's one less thing we got to worry about. If we can take out the variables, it increases our success rate. Now there's 1.5 million different kinds of powered snares out there. A lot of them kind of difficult to make. Anyway, it's kind of difficult to make. What we want to do is the numbers again. We want to make these as simple as possible. If you notice on that loop how I tied that double loop will fight you in a powered snare. I'm going to make a gigantic snare here.
Does the color of cordage matter?
Yes. All right. I got that double loop, correct? And my snare. Now when this pulls down by the animal's own tension, it tightens. Okay? If I got this powered and this thing comes snapping up, it could tighten right there. That's going to not let our snare close. So on a powered snare, we want a single loop. And through my very unscientific methods of testing, I found out that when you make your loop on the end of here, we make our end of our loop to start our snare. If you want this small loop, 3 times the size of the diameter of your cordage. That gives us a balance between fast and tight enough. If you have this loop too tight, the cord won't slide through. If you have it too loose, the cord slides through too good and will relax. So basically that's what I want, so it's fast. But yet, when I let go, it doesn't release. So 3 times the size of the diameter of whatever cordage you're using. Now I'm going to say something here amongst a bunch of survivalists that could possibly get me hung. Paracord is not the cord. In my personal opinion, paracord is for tarps, shelters, making water filters, for trapping. Leave this in your pack. It sucks.
Paracord.
I'll show you why, hopefully. One thing, paracord generally on smaller animals is too big. It's too big around. They see this stuff. So what we always like to do, what you hear everybody say, is strip the inner cords out of paracord, right? So now I got this piece of paracord. See the shape of that? It's like a soup sandwich.